Identify yourself.
Okay. Well, my name is Henry Ortelt. I am proud to say I have two honorary doctor's degree from local universities. Not local, one is in, both from Minnesota, though. And I was born in Berlin, Germany in 1921.
Can we back up a second? How do you spell your last name?
My last name spells O-E-R-T-E-L-T.
Thank you.
And middle initial is A for Arthur.
Okay.
And so, yeah, as I said, I was born in Germany in 1921 in Berlin. And I was 12 years old when Hitler came to power.
Before he came to power, did you notice a lot of anti-Semitism?
No.
Before he came to power?
Before he came to power, I was not experiencing any anti-Semitism. No, I wasn't. I grew up in an area which was more a blue-collar area. We didn't experience anti-Semitism before, no.
And Dan, should I jump in with questions, or do you have a list of questions, or should I jump in?
No, you jump in.
Okay.
Yeah.
Henry, maybe can you just explain, just describe for obviously somebody who doesn't know about your life before 1933, what your life was like, your family, your friends, the kinds of things you liked to do?
Well, my mother was an early widow, and I grew up with a brother who is 6 years older than I am. And normal life, my mother was fighting for her existence. She was a dressmaker, and I grew up with under meager financial circumstances, which as a little kid I didn't realize, of course. Looking back at it, I realized that.
And your father?
My father died when I was about 2 years old.
2 years old.
Yes.
What was his occupation, though?
He was an office manager.
And why did he die young?
Yes, very young. Yeah.
What was the cause of death?
I have no idea. I don't know.
So maybe just describe, if you could, just the where you were living, the conditions, the school you were going to, just to give people a sense of what life was like before 1933.
Well, before 1933, before Hitler came to what was actually normal life. I went to school, a public school, and had no bad experiences that I can remember at all at that time, not until 33. Things started, of course, in 1933 when Hitler took power immediately. I felt his presence and ideology in school as a student.
Were there many Jewish families in your community?
And where I lived, there were not many Jewish families. There were some, yes, but not too many. It was not a predominantly Jewish area by no means.
But your neighbors were aware you were Jewish?
Oh, yes. The neighbors were aware that we were Jewish, and they were very nice and decent at those days.
What did your mom do to make ends meet when it was difficult for her without your dad and stuff? How did she?
Well, she was a dressmaker, and she tried to find a job making dresses for people that she knew. And then for a while, she worked in a factory, too. In a local area, there was a factory, and she worked there and had some income there, of course.
Do you remember if after your dad moved, you moved from one neighborhood to another?
No,
you stayed.
I was born under that address that we lived in, and that's where I was picked up by the Nazis from that address.
Tell me that address again. I'm sorry.
The address was Berlin, Udenauer Straße, number one. Udenauer, that's after a town in Holland, Udenauer. Udenauer Straße, street,
right.
Number one. And I lived there, I was born there, and lived there till I was picked up by the Nazis.
Okay, and so maybe, describe just if you could, from 1933, how things changed.
Well, 1933, things changed quite rapidly. I noticed right away in school, as I said, it was a public school, I noticed right away that it started out that the teachers ignored, there were a couple of three other Jewish students in our class. The teachers ignored the Jewish students, even if we had an answer to his questions. We were never chosen to answer, even though we could raise our hands as much as we wanted to. And so that was one thing. And then I am from a musician's family, and I was blessed with a good singing voice. And I was in a school choir. Suddenly I was not allowed to be participating in the choir anymore. Being Jewish. Jewish kids suddenly were dismissed from the choir.
So there were not too many Jewish pupils in the class.
There were not, there were two or three other students at the time, I remember, in a class of maybe 30 to 35 kids. And not only that, I was also on a soccer team. And I suddenly was not allowed to participate in school soccer team anymore either.
Did they tell you why?
Yes. Yeah. They
make it clear why they were not participating.
Jews are not allowed to participate in it anymore. They did not hide it from me. And of course, as a little kid, but by that time I was maybe 13, not quite 14 years old. I couldn't understand it, of course, naturally. I was upset. But at those days, all these restrictions that came little by little, the known as the dehumanization process that Hitler introduced against the Jews, you always thought this was temporary. Somebody must come to their senses. And like those teachers, the music teacher at that time told me, Henry, don't worry about it. I know there's something weird. I'll let you know this will be rescinded, and so on and so forth. And then not only that, then eventually when I was about 14 and a half years old, I was dismissed from school altogether. Like, Jewish kids were not allowed to go to public school, period.
So you stayed at home with your mother?
I stayed at home with my mother for a while. I mean, I stayed at home, not for a while, not doing anything for a while until...
Where was your brother at this
time? My brother still was at the university.
Oh.
Yeah, he was at the university. He was a brilliant student. In fact, he had jumped one class in the gymnasium, as it was called in Germany. And so he was brilliant, and actually even at the university where all Jewish students already had been dismissed, he was still kept as the last one because some of the professors were sort of like putting a word in for him.
Uh-huh.
And so he was at the university.
The
yes.
last one to be dismissed.
Yes, yes, from the Berlin University, yes.
And Henry, I'm sorry, you were about to talk about you know, what you did after you got kicked out of school, but can you just talk briefly when you were kicked off, before you were pushed out of school and you were just kicked off the soccer team and the choir, mm-hmm. Did you notice that your friends or your schoolmates treated you any differently? Did they start seeing you?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Friends and schoolmates certainly treated me differently. In fact, I had a friend that I was close with. And,
can you, and make sure you could just look at my dad. I know it's kind of awkward. I'm asking questions
yeah.
for you, but
okay,
just feel free.
Sure.
So it's
yeah.
more of a conversation.
Yeah, naturally. Okay. Yeah. So the school kids, the buddies changed. Particularly one friend I had that I was very close with. And we hung out together, and I went to his parents' house, and suddenly he didn't even say hello to me anymore. And as I approached him and said to him, what's the matter? Why, what's happening? He said, I still see, as he put his arms aside, he said, I never knew how horrible you people were. And that was based on the propaganda machine that Hitler had now going against the Jews. And of course, the teachers were instructed and had to actually talk about bad things about Jews in the classes. And of course, the kids start to believe this kind of stuff.
What was your reaction?
My reaction was just I felt terrible. It was absolute misery. And of course, at that time then, of the Jewish kids could not participate in any school activities whatsoever anymore. No outings, no visits to museums and so on and so forth. So just all was cut out.
So this was kind of a gradual or kind of a sudden change?
It wasn't really so gradual. These things just came and came going into the door suddenly. There was no warning about those things. Of course, then, as I mentioned, Hitler's dehumanization process, of course, it went on and on. All kinds of other steps happened. But to come back to what I did then, after I was home, after I was dismissed from school, I found one man who took me into his furniture shop, and I learned to become a designer and builder of fine furniture, which is actually what happened eventually. It was actually instrumental in my survival, one of them. The book that I wrote is called An Unbroken Chain, My Journey Through the Nazi Holocaust. The Unbroken Chain is a chain without interruption, consisting of 18 links. 18 has a particular meaning, of course, in the Jewish, 18, in Hebrew is chai. was also chai, also in Hebrew, is life. You know, l'chaim, chai. So it's life. So these 18 links are uninterrupted, intertwined. And each link represents a position, condition, a break that happened here and there, which helped me survive. In other words, I'm lecturing for 40 years at universities and high schools. Sometimes I'm being asked, since the book is out, students will ask me, Mr. Ortel, what is the most important link out of that chain?
What's the answer?
The answer is very simply, the seemingly least important link is as important as the seemingly most important link, because either link falling out of the chain, I wouldn't be here, whichever whatever link it is. So
interesting title.
yes, and that's why the book is this is why the book is so successful too. I'm proud to say, and things went on while I was working now to learn the trade. And by the way, as I mentioned,
I assume it was a Gentile.
Beg your pardon?
They had the furniture shop.
Yes. Yes,
he was friendly.
Yes.
He knew you were Jewish,
I assume. Yes.
But he wanted to help you.
Yeah, he wanted to help people. He was very good. And it was dangerous for him even. So because Hitler had declared at that time any person just associating with a Jew will be put before the tribunals. And so even people that sometimes meant to be friendly were afraid of being friendly. But of course, on the other hand, I don't know if this is the right point. We should never forget that there were some wonderful, brave people that really literally stuck out their neck and helped Jewish people. I experienced that. In my book, I'm writing about three non-Jewish people that were instrumental in my survival. One of them is my friend Richard, a wonderful Christian man. And the other one was a foreman that I worked for, Herr Kasper, Mr. Kasper.
Did he protect you? Did he hide you somewhere?
No, he didn't. This friend, my friend Richard, offered to hide me, but he was a bachelor living in a one-room apartment. And I said, you know, Richard, I'm sorry, so nice of you, but I can't accept it because I can't go without my brother and father. Let's drop for a moment.
Yeah.
Oh. So, yeah.
There were three people, Richard, Herr Kasper, and...
And what was the other one? Oh, gosh, I can't think of it right now.
I think the people that were called righteous people, too.
Yeah, righteous people, yeah, that's right.
So maybe tell us how old you were when Richard was helping you.
Well, we became friends. And how we became friends, a long story. I met him somewhere boating.
Was he older than you?
Yes, he was older, yeah. He died a few years ago. And I met him. And at first he didn't know that I was Jewish. And then eventually it came to the point we met. And he was a very well-to-do young man. And we met and we went to he invited me to go to fancy restaurants. And that was always, I was afraid of that. Even that was during the time when we had to wear the star. But I took the star off. I was really risking it. But so at one time, then I had to tell him that Richard, I don't think I can't see anymore because I expect that I might be picked up any moment now because we had some feeling. By that time, that was a time when only 90% of the Jews of Germany had been picked up and sent to concentration camps in the early 40s, and. So he wasn't shocked at all. He said, oh my gosh, he says, you know something? You better come and live with me. And then I told him, Richard, that's very nice of you, but I got a brother and a mother, and I can't leave without them. He said, oh, I forgot that. He says, don't be silly. He said, in your one-bedroom apartment, in one-room apartment? He says, I'll find somebody that will hide you guys. So
wow.
He was one. And then not only this, during that time, Jews, the war had started in 1939, and since 1939, people received ration cards, which were very meager to begin with, but Jews received only 50% of the ration cards. When we went and to pick up our food ration cards, the guy took a scissors and snipped off half of it, threw the half of it away, and handed us graciously our half. And so you had to identify yourself always who you are, so they knew that you're Jewish. The identification cards had the big J on there for Jew, and so on and so forth. And why they had all those papers, and maybe would have wanted to photograph them. I don't know.
But you were required to wear
the star.
The star.
Yes. And as I describe in my book, I made myself an artificial star that I could pin on and take off.
Were most of them sewn on?
Oh, yeah, that was the law. Yeah. They were to be sewn on in stitches of no more than 1 millimeter apart from each other, all around that star. Yes.
But you made this pin system so it looked like it?
I cut open a tin can and cut out the form of the star and took one of these stars, which were cloth, and glued it onto that thing. And then, as I was a handy fellow, I took my soldering iron, soldered a pin on the back, which I bent down, and so now I could stick it in, which was a stupid thing to do, of course, at those days. Oh, there she is.
If they caught you wearing that star,
Well, I was a young fellow, you know, nothing happens to me, of course not, you know, but I knew of other people.
You were invincible.
I was invincible, you're right. I knew a friend of mine had a loose corner on a star, and he was stopped by the Gestapo, the secret police, the Nazi police. Stopped by Gestapo, and two other friends that were with him witnessed that one of the Nazi guys tore the star off, and the other guy grabbed him by the neck, shoved him into the black limousine, and we never saw our friend again. Never. At those days, you think this is all temporary, you know, and never saw him again. So I was fully aware of the danger. I didn't realize that was stupid, which I realize nowadays, and later it was a stupid thing to do. It really wasn't worth it. But on the other hand, I wanted to go to places that I wasn't allowed to. Jews were not allowed to go to any public place anymore. No restaurants, no movie theaters, no concert halls, no parks, no beaches, no libraries, no public places. And I just couldn't buy that. I figured
you could remove the star.
Oh, yeah, yeah. My family was dated back in the country for centuries, and I like some of the Nazis even could date back. We were longer dating back. So I when I went out of the house, at those days, people walked out of the house. Everybody had a briefcase, a flat briefcase. When I went out of the house, that star was there. And when I was a few blocks away, the briefcase came up covering the star, and I looked around and walked for a few more steps, and my hand went underneath it, and the star went off and went right into my pocket. And the briefcase came down. And the reversed thing was an evening.
Good thinking.
yeah, it was good thinking, but so stupid.
But a little risky.
Sure.
What if you were stopped and asked for your papers? Because that was a problem, right? I mean, if you didn't have the star on, you still might be questioned.
Sure, particularly in war times. And I was a young fellow. I was, by that time, in my beginning 20s. Oh, yeah.
what was your plan if you were stopped without the star and questioned?
There's no plan. You got to understand that at that time was the law that every person in Germany had to have an ID card with them, just like you have to have your driver's license with you. And if you don't have your driver's license with you, they check you out, right?
Sure.
And at that time, if you didn't have any ID with you, they check you out. Yeah. And then if you were found to be without the star, that was it. You were taken away and never seen again, because in those days people were carted off right away to the concentration camps.
How long of a period was this where you were wearing the star that way?
Until I was picked up. It started in 1941, and I was picked up, sent to the concentration camp in June of 43.
So you kept this up for a couple of years?
Oh, yeah.
Where was your mother and brother during that period?
Well, around, just like I. Oh, I don't know, yeah.
So
yeah.
Can you go back to the working for the furniture maker and the apprenticeship? Were you asked to wear a star back then, or was that?
Well, starting 1941.
Oh, sorry,
I was asked to wear the star during that time. Yes.
So not while you were working for the furniture maker.
Well, you had to wear the star anytime, no matter what you were doing and where you're going. No, as funny as it may sound, you wore the star in a concentration camp, once you were there, and Theresienstadt, my first one, Theresienstadt. You wore the star, even though there were nothing but Jews in there.
I noticed that in some of the pictures I've seen that the stars were put on the back. Not always.
In some countries, not in Germany. In Germany, you wore it on the left side. In some parts of Poland, they wore it on the back and front even.
Yes,
yeah.
Right. What about the people that owned the store owners, Jewish owners that had stores?
Jewish owners that were stores in 1938, the law came out that Jewish stores had to be marked. First in 1933, when Hitler came to power, Jewish stores were boycotted. He declared a boycott of Jewish stores. Now, not everybody knew that the store was Jewish. And some people thought that a store that wasn't even Jewish owned was owned by non-Jews, they would boycott it, and then so they made a stupid thing. Then they came out to clear this up, or the law came that Jewish businesses had to be marked by having the owner's name in letters about a foot high, white straight block letters, on the windows or on the door, right across. And so now, of course, this was also, this was before Kristallnacht, Kristallnacht, when everything was destroyed. This was, of course, also helping them when Kristallnacht came to destroy the Jewish businesses and the facilities because they were marked.
So how long did you work for the furniture maker, and how did that end?
Almost 4 years.
4 good years,
but apprenticeships took 4 years in Germany at those days. I don't know if it's still that way. In order to be called a full-fledged professional in that profession, it takes 4 years, and I just finished 4 years when all business, Jewish businesses had to be closed by that time, and everybody was called was put out on slavery and slavery work condition. Jewish owners, business owners, doctors, lawyers, they were all thrown out in slavery work condition, mostly construction sites, road construction, and so was I. So was I then.
So you went from the furniture apprentice, you finished the apprenticeship after 4 years, and what year was that?
Let's see, in 1940.
Yes. So what did you do then? You said you got a job as a construction engineer?
Yeah, then I was sent to constructions. Actually, I think end of 1939 it was already, that doesn't matter that much. Yeah, then I was put on road construction, and then eventually I was taken away to work in some other outfits. And oh yeah,
were there other people other than people wearing the star? Were there other?
The Jews were kept separate as separate groups by their own.
Separate construction groups.
Yes, the foremen, the bosses, of course, were non-Jews.
How did they treat you at that time?
In general, I didn't have any bad experience with that. No.
Were you friends with Richard during that time?
Oh yes, that's all during that time. And Richard, I wanted to say, the way Richard, not only that he had asked me to stay with him, to hide me, when that didn't take place, I started to talk about the food. The Jews received only 50% of the ration cards. He came in late in the evening at night with an armful of food. And not only an armful of food, he knew that we lacked music because Jews had to give up their record players and radio. At those days, you had record players, you know, and radios. And he schlepped a record player. At those days, the smallest thing was a box like that you opened and flipped and had to crank up. And he schlepped that thing at night, bringing a couple of records along, so we had some music. Now we lived in an apartment building, and now you got to imagine, Jews were not allowed to have music. There were some Nazis in the apartment building. We had some bad neighbor Nazis there, one particular family. And if they would have heard us having music, we would have been in trouble. So what we did, we put that music box on the dining room table, put a blanket over our heads, and then there was the record going underneath that thing. And he himself was with us under that blanket, even though he could hear that and did hear the music anytime freely he wanted to.
What a good friend, but he risked himself.
Very, very high risk. Yeah, wonderful.
So then he offered to take you guys to his apartment.
Yes, which I didn't accept then. Because it was impossible.
Because that would have included your mother and brother.
Yeah. Right. In one bedroom apartment he had there, and so that wouldn't have been any good. No.
Nice offer,
but yeah. And then we would have to be separated too because he couldn't. He said, you know, I'm finding spots for you, you know, here and there.
Yeah.
But we didn't accept it, and who knows what would have happened.
Danger. I mean, all that shutting down the shops and wearing the stars and that. So
yes, you were. We are. You live constantly in danger, and it's an interesting thing.
Do they have vandalism at the shops before Kristallnacht?
No.
Some of the chefs?
Well, yeah, some here and there you have fun, but rarely, really. But Kristallnacht was organized. Yeah. Kristallnacht was organized, and it was organized because of a young Jewish fellow that killed one super Nazi.
Yeah.
And in France it happened. And he was visiting France, and he killed one Nazi because he heard that his father was badly beaten up by the Nazi thugs. And so, as a revenge for that, Hitler instigated the Kristallnacht. And I've written about this in my book, by the way, and several other things. Yeah. And by the way, the other brave man that I'm talking about was another friend of mine. Fritz was his name. Yeah.
So Fritz and Herr Kasper, do you want to tell us about them?
Well, Fritz knew that I was working on road constructions and under very bad circumstances. And by the way, Jews received only half of the payments that regular workers received. So that's that thing. But of course, Jews didn't need much money because you couldn't buy anything anymore anyways. But Fritz was also running his own road construction company. And he says, I'm going to get you to work for me. And so he applied to the Nazis to get me to work for him, which was, of course, a bad thing to do because people couldn't just apply for one Jew to work for him. He had to have a big group or so, you know. And so I knew it was dangerous for him. So he put himself open to the Nazis as a sympathizer of Jews, of course. And, of course, it was denied. And not only that it was denied, he lost a lot of jobs because of that. So it was... wonderful man.
How did you know him? How did you meet him?
Well, he lived in the same house that we lived in that Odenauer Straße that I mentioned earlier. So he lived at the same house. So and so he knew my mother and my brother, of course, and so, yeah.
And Herr Kasper?
Herr Kasper, once after I worked for a while on road constructions, Herr Kasper... I was assigned to a woodwork factory because I had my background in furniture making. So but of course they didn't make any furniture. They made barracks for the soldiers, for German soldiers, for Nazi soldiers. And so I was assigned to work for this outfit, and Herr Kasper was the foreman. And I, as I said, he's one of my saving links in the book. And he appeared to be a super Nazi. He was always kind of rough with us. Not bad, but rough, short, and loud-mouthed, and bellowing. And so we suddenly, just to make the long story short, it's described in the book very good, he comes in and he says that in his neighboring factory, there's a work of Jews working there. And he found out that the Nazi trucks are loading them up to send them to Auschwitz. And he said he understood that we would be next. And he said, clean up your places as if nobody ever worked here and get out of here right away. And so that's how we escaped from the Nazi truck. And that was about a year before I actually was picked up, and these people were sent to Auschwitz. And I don't think that I could have made another year in Auschwitz. When you look at my final results at the end when I was liberated, I weighed 82 pounds. And another year in Auschwitz before that, I wouldn't have lasted any longer.
Wow. So what did you do after that, after you cleaned up and
nothing.
Like nobody had been in that?
Just hung around. Nothing. Not a thing.
Did they form ghettos?
No, not in Germany.
Not in Berlin?
Not in Berlin. Not in Germany. They didn't form ghettos.
They did the deportations from Germany.
Yeah, deportations from the houses. Well, we were picked up, sent to what you would call a collection center, and then from there loaded on to trucks and sent and taken to the train stations.
But to go back just for a second, so for that year, you were just lying low and trying not to get in trouble, or what
yeah,
was going on?
Yeah, that's about it. That's about it, actually. Just lying low, not trying to get in trouble. My brother was still working, and my mother was
what
still...
What kind of work did he do?
Well, he's a cantor.
Oh.
But at that time, he was teaching at a Jewish school, and then the Jewish schools were closed up, of course, too. and he was assigned to a furniture mover, home mover. Excuse me. He was assigned to, and he worked carrying furniture and pianos and stuff like that. And he was fortunately in good shape. He was a, He was a very sports-minded person at the time.
That probably helped save him, too, by being a good
strong
shape.
Yes, that's right.
And evidently you were in good shape, too.
Yes, I was at that time, even though I was small and a small build, but I worked physically on road work, and even in the furniture, carrying lumber, carrying furniture, and so on and so forth. So I was I was in good physical shape at that time.
And so just tell us what happened at the end of that year, when things kind of took a turn.
The end of the year before I was picked up, you mean?
Yeah, or just now, maybe, did you want to talk about anything else before you got picked up?
Well, there's really nothing much else to talk about. You noticed that people, Jewish families disappeared left and right. Your family was all gone. My friends were all gone. I was one of about 10 friends in the musician group. They were all gone. I was the only one left.
Which Jewish friends were picked up?
Deported? Yes, they were all picked up and deported to concentration camps.
Never heard from again.
I'm out of the 10 guy group. I'm the only survivor. Never saw any of them again.
It's unusual that you were the last one to be picked up.
Yes.
How do you explain that?
I have no idea. At one time in March of 1943, Hitler declared, "Congratulations to the German population. 90% of the Jews have now been, quote unquote, evacuated." And so I figured out in my great mathematician ran that I'm one of the 10%. But I had no idea why. They couldn't pick him up all at once, of course, you know. And so I just was fortunate.
I guess you were lucky.
Yeah, that's one of my saving links, too, that I was picked up that late.
So describe to us when you were picked up and what happened.
Well, you hear bangs on your door in the middle of the night, and you open the door and you look into the faces of two black uniformed SS Gestapo guys. And one guy looks at his watch and says, "You got 15 minutes, one suitcase per person, let's go." And you run around like a chicken with a cut off head and throw things in the suitcases. And I remember my mother warning, "Don't take this fancy stuff, you only have one suitcase. You know, you're going to go to a concentration camp, that's not going to be a fancy place. Just get the stuff that's important." And so, exactly after 15 minutes, we're up, suitcases had to be closed, and we were taken down to a waiting truck. And we were taken to one of those collection centers that I mentioned.
But you were aware, evidently, of, you know, when you were deported, you didn't know where you were going.
No, you didn't know, but you know that you would be sent to one of the concentration camps. You knew that because the word got out that people were sent to concentration camps. Auschwitz, we knew about already, and we knew at that time that that's one of the worst, and I had no idea. After about a week in a collection center, then we were loaded up again, and then I found myself on the way to what turned out to be my mother, my brother. And by that time, his fiancée had come to us, hidden from her apartment. Because she came home from work, her parents had been picked up, and the house was sealed. She couldn't get in.
Were they aware that some of the people that were picked up and deported would be going to some kill, be exterminated?
We heard rumors, but you didn't believe it. You heard rumors. In fact, there was one guy at one time, one guy had been picked up. It was not a close friend of ours, but an acquaintance that I knew. And he, that when our friendship group was almost completely still functioning, he came suddenly running in, and he says he had escaped from the transport to a concentration camp.
Jewish man.
Right? And he says he's on the way trying to get to Switzerland. But he wanted to warn us, he says, "If you can get away, don't worry." He says, "I've seen," he described that the train stopped at the clearing in the middle of the woods. And he said that they picked out the people out of the train. There was a huge semi-truck with its engine going, a huge semi-truck. And people were driven into that semi-truck. And there was a pipe going into the semi-truck, he noticed. And these people were gassed. These were the early gas chambers. And we didn't believe a word he said. He says, "This guy must be out of his mind. How is that possible?"
So you heard what he saw and witnessed, but he
didn't believe it.
Didn't believe it.
Didn't believe it.
Did he make it to Switzerland?
I never know.
And what was your thinking and your mom and your brother and his fiancée about leaving or staying?
Well, we were trying to get out of Germany a long time before. We had some contact in America, but that was denied as an insufficient amount that this man put up for us. And he was a distant relative in New York, and he was a rich guy. And when he found out that it was denied, he says it's impossible. He says he could, with the amount that he put up and guaranteed, he could feed a whole army for 5 years, not just the family. And he said at that time, these are politics, and that was under Roosevelt. And so he said, but don't worry, we're gonna fix it. And of course, in the meantime, then the war had started, the consulate was closed. And so that was that. So in a way, I blame Roosevelt, because he had been approached to make immigration quotas, and he never increased them, never did. He was approached many, many times.
So the process was that this distant relative in the States would apply to the administration, basically, and say, I have this family in Europe, and I'd like them to come to immigrate here.
They had to guarantee for 5 years that they would be not a burden to the state for 5 years. Because it takes five years to apply for citizenship. Then once you're a citizen, you would be a burden of the state if you wanted to, yes. Which, of course, so.
And when did you hear that was denied? When did this relative contact
you? Oh, that was still the relative didn't contact. We were called to the consulate when it was still open. And we were in the consulate and we were figured, no, we can never, there were thousands of people milling around the consulate with the same ideas. And so we came in front of the consul. He was very nice. He offered us even a cup of coffee, which we hadn't seen for a long time. And then he opened his files and he says, you know something, I'm sorry to say that the amount put up is insufficient for you. You better get in touch with him and tell him that he has to come up with more. Sorry about it. See you next time.
And what year was that?
That was in the beginning of 39, before the war started. In 1939, the war started.
Well, if the funds were sufficient, it would have been a different story.
Oh, yes.
His relative is saying it's not a matter of the funds because they were sufficient.
Which is nowadays proven, by the way. Okay. These were politics. They didn't want to have too many Jews in here.
So you packed your one suitcase each, and you made it to this, they took you to this, what did they call it?
This was called camp located in Czechoslovakia. The Germans called it Theresienstadt, and the Czechs called it Terezin. I described that in the book too.
Yeah. And how was it that your brother's fiance was able to? You said her parents were taken when she was out, and she managed to find you.
She came to our house, and when she couldn't get back to her home, so it was a foregone conclusion that she had to stay with us. Not a safe hiding place, but...
And so when you were taken, she was taken too, you all went?
We all went together, yes.
What about her parents?
Her parents had been picked up before.
They were deported before.
They were, in fact, they picked up... Jews, some of the Jews were assigned to factory work. You at that time, one of the big outfits, maybe you heard of Siemens. They hired thousands of Jews, forced labor.
Yeah.
And they worked for that outfit, and my wife's mother, Inge's mother, worked there too. And they were picked up from the workplaces. Like in my case, when my foreman warned us that these people from that factory were picked up there, and we would be picked up from him, and we were about 15 guys working for him. And so the other big companies, they didn't pick him up from the homes, they didn't bother, they knew they would find him at work and picked him up from work. And when my sister-in-law, my brother's fiancé at that time, Sonia, went to her home. It was sealed. She couldn't get in, and she knew, of course, that her parents were picked up.
So
they would seal the apartments.
So describe the day or the night that you arrived in Theresienstadt.
Well, the night in Theresienstadt was an old, what's the word? What?
By train, truck
to the train, and train to the train instead. And it was an old, military base, and originally, and there were, it was 400 or 500 years old, dilapidated, places and all that stuff. It was a town where people had lived in before. They cleared it, and so the Jews can be thrown in there. And so we were in one of the big houses in the attics on the first night, late on the attics, and we found out that it was infested with lice, fleas, and bed bugs. Right away, the first night, we were bitten up. And then, of course, from then on, every time, people run around with welts all over the arms and open up. Yeah.
And you were still together at that stage?
Yes, my brother and I. Women were separated.
You were separated from your mother and...
Yes, my mother and my now sister-in-law is now here and said that they were in a different area. My brother and I were fortunate to stay together. And this is also one of the saving links in my book. My brother and I have different last names. From one mother, which, by the way, according to Jewish law, makes us full siblings, according to Jewish law. So we are not half brothers, we are full brothers. But we are from two fathers. His name is Messerschmidt.
Your mother was married twice. Second wife?
Yes. My mother was my father's second, yeah. Yeah. And in many cases, not in all cases, but in most cases, they would purposely separate families. And one simple thing to find out that your family is the last name, same last name. That's one of my saving links, that we were saved because we had different names, that we were staying together till the very last 4 weeks of our entire incarceration.
And what is his last name?
His last name is Messerschmidt.
Like the airplane?
There's a difference. The airplane... The airplane is with double T on the end. The Jewish Messerschmitts are DT.
Oh.
Yeah.
So your brother is, what's his full name?
Kurt Messerschmidt, yeah. And as I said, and he's a cantor.
Is he
retired
now?
Oh, yeah.
And so you were in this attic for 2 weeks?
Well, yeah, for about 2 weeks. And then we were put into other quarters with bunk beds and stuff like that. But the same messy outfit, also. Bed bugs and stuff like that.
So just if you could describe how long you were there and what the general conditions.
Well, Theresienstadt is actually considered one of the quote-unquote milder concentration camp. Let me just give you a couple of examples of a mild concentration camp. The statistics show that after its existence of nearly 3 years, when it was liberated by the Russians in that case, out of 15,000 children that had been sent to this camp, just to talk about children, less than 100 had survived. It's a mild concentration camp. So the conditions were miserable, particularly for old folks. Yet Hitler wanted to make a show place out of that. And things were taking place in this camp, art performances, musical performance, theater, concerts, operas were taking place in that camp. And they made sure that all the Jewish artists were sent to that camp. This camp was the people in there was a conglomeration of the finest and most number of artists ever assembled in one place. So they had them all there. And so these things were, as it turns out, which I didn't know then, secretly filmed. By that time, the world had come to find out about Auschwitz and the murdering concentration camps. And he wanted to make a film to show, what are you talking about? Look at these Jews, they're living wonderful. They're singing, they're dancing, they're having soccer games. It was all instigated and was all prepared. But of course, it showed only that side that was there. The other side, the old folks starving and the children starving to death, they didn't show that, of course. So now I and my brother and I, we would avail ourselves to the musical possibilities, and we were able to perform in a huge choir. My brother was a soloist even at times.
So that helped.
And besides that, you got a little extra ration, tin can of some food, which we don't know what it was really. We thought it was like chopped liver, but looking back, I think it was like cat food or something like that. We didn't care at the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Red
Cross was coming through there. They were sent through and they were hoodwinked. They would set up special facilities for the Red Cross. Would make even set up a kindergarten where the kids were fed beautiful things and were dressed nicely for that purpose, specifically erected barrack
for
the propaganda. And the course came there, and since Danish Jews came there, the King of Denmark sent a delegation to find out how his Danish people are living there. They were all hoodwinked by the Nazis.
What was actually happening in Turin and stuff that they didn't see?
What they didn't see, the starvation and sickness of old people. They didn't see that ten people lived in a room of 14 by 14 feet. They didn't see that. These people were led around, and they were even, these people were allowed to ask inmates. But you know, if I was asked, with the Nazis standing around, I couldn't tell them what's going on. We were hoping that they would see it, and they didn't see it. They didn't see anything.
You think they would have gone beyond that area that was that looked so peaceful?
Yeah. So they came reported that while the Jews are restrained to their quarters, but they are doing okay and
being well treated.
Yeah. And they showed one old folks area where they served them cake and coffee. And the Nazi papers wrote the next day, while the Jews in the camps are drinking coffee and having cake, our soldiers bleed to death on the fronts. Big propaganda thing.
And how long were you there?
Until I think started about 14 months. And then suddenly we were loaded up to on cattle cars and went to were sent to Auschwitz.
Cattle cars?
Yes.
Crowded cattle cars.
People were not counted out. They were shoved in. They milled out in front of it and were shoved in by gun butts and sticks, driven into the cattle cars. You have seen those pictures.
What precipitated the transport to Auschwitz? Why did you leave Reichenstadt and go to Auschwitz?
Why? You had no choice. You were ordered.
But I mean, do you know why they sent you there?
Well, the Auschwitz was really, as it turns out, a transition camp. They sent people, and it became overcrowded, and then they sent people out.
Have you heard about Auschwitz?
Oh, yes. Auschwitz was the one camp you for sure didn't want to be, we know. Although others were just as bad, as it turns out. But you were sent, taken out, and then, of course, sometimes people were sent to some smaller camps where they had working facilities. Like when you know about Schindler's List, was a smaller camp with the work facilities. When some factories requested labor power.
Did you know why you were going to? I mean, did you know when you were pushed into these cattle cars? Did you know you were going to?
We were notified the day before. Tomorrow morning, you're going to be at the train station.
They told you. Oh, yes. Going to Auschwitz?
No, not to Auschwitz. No. You're going to be sent to a labor camp.
A labor camp.
Yes.
They didn't say which.
Oh no,
camp.
You had no idea. No idea.
When did it? How long of a journey was it, and when did it become clear where you?
Was about 2.5 days ride, although the journey is not that far. The train stopped constantly because sometimes the tracks were blown up, and then they just stopped often. I don't know why they stopped often otherwise.
Sanitation. Sanitation.
Who knows? No. Sanitation? Oh, no. You were not allowed to set foot outside. In fact, that's the thing. We didn't get anything to eat or to drink during those 2.5 days. And if you think that's bad, you're talking about sanitation. There was no way to relieve yourself. There was not even a lousy pail. Not a pot or a lousy pail. And you can imagine the mess that was floating around on the ground eventually.
And the odors must have
yeah, and people died. We were piling up people at the end of the wagon, and there was even some room to sit down. But if you looked at the floor, you didn't want to sit down if you had a little bit of strength left.
And so when did it become clear that this was, after two and a half days, that this was Auschwitz?
Well, when you were there. Well, in fact, in our case, it was a little before. We were in the neighborhood when some guy looked out of that slit window there, which was Bob Wire. He looked out and he says, "You know something? I'm from this area. I know where we are heading. This looks like Auschwitz is coming up." We thought, no, they told us we were being sent to a labor camp. We didn't believe it, but that's what it was.
Did any of the people crawl out through that small opening?
You couldn't.
You couldn't because of the barbed wire?
Barbed wire, yeah.
Over the small opening.
Yes, oh yes. And you couldn't remove the wire. And even if you removed the wire, it was much too small to crawl out, I think.
And you're still with your brother?
Yes, we were still together.
And then what happened when you arrived there and they unloaded the train?
Well, then they unloaded the train and they sorted out. They asked who needs medical attention. Step forward, we need you to work. We will treat you, and we will even give you a couple of days of rest. And so some people went for that. We knew that it wouldn't work anyways. And there's some people that didn't need it that figured that if I say I'm sick and they get a couple of days of rest, they went for that. Regretfully, they were hoodwinked.
Was Mengele in that camp?
He was, but we didn't know about it then. We didn't know about Mengele at that time. I didn't know.
So you and your brother, no matter how you felt, you knew that you should say that you're in good health.
Yeah. In fact, we had recognized the only chance to survive is to be able to work. To be able to work, and as it turns out, sometimes to keep on working, even if you don't feel so hot, you may have fever or something, this or that bothered you, you better report to work.
Yeah, you know what the alternative was.
Oh, yes, exactly.
And what was the work?
Well, most stone quarries in many cases, and sometimes digging ditches around there for drainage. And that's what I did at first in Theresienstadt also, by the way, dig ditches. But then, to come back to it, I let it be known that I know how to design and build furniture. I was called into furniture workshop then. And this, of course, is one of my saving links, because I didn't have to work as hard, like sometimes 8 to 10 hours in stone quarries. And I could pace myself. I could push the pencil for drawings first, which I knew that a little bit of food I would get would not be used up, the few calories wouldn't be used up that fast. So you had to use your mind, you had to use your noodle all the time while you're there too, of course. So yeah, and so then, even then in Auschwitz, we were actually taken to a satellite camp from Auschwitz, a few miles away from Auschwitz, which was called Goloschau.
When did they tattoo you?
In Auschwitz, yeah. At the arrival in Auschwitz, yes.
When you arrived?
Yeah, when you arrived, yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. At the arrival in Auschwitz. We were sorted out as we arrived in Auschwitz.
Yeah, you can make them out.
Mm-hmm.
What is the number?
B11291. The funny thing is, if you ask me what the number is, I never remember it. I always have to look at it, which at one time my life depends on, because we weren't allowed to look at it when you were asked the first time. They would ask you, what's your name? And it was announced, your name is your number. So that was on. And our hair was shorn and everything. And then we were thrown into barracks in Auschwitz. And after a few weeks, we were taken to that satellite camp where again, I was able to work in my profession.
Could have been Birkenau?
That was Birkenau. Yeah, Auschwitz-Birkenau I was first. Right. That B stands for Birkenau.
Not far from each other.
No, they were completely exactly neighboring, yeah. And then from Birkenau I was sent to the other camp, Goloschau, a small camp, a 1,000-man camp, which had a cement factory and a stone quarry. My brother worked in a stone quarry, and I was fortunate that I was working could work in a workshop. Oh, I was ordered to make a huge conference desk for the Nazi office, made out of solid mahogany wood. They had all the stuff there, and all by hand, of course. And so, it turns out I never finished it, because I was then this was Auschwitz area, and as the Russians from the east came close to Auschwitz, we were taken out of that camp, ordered out of that camp. Put in marching position, death camp was a death march, as it turns out.
So even when you first got there, that was the assignment, was to make this giant desk.
When I first
arrived in Auschwitz,
not right away. No, they didn't know right away who I was. I had to let it be known. I first worked also in some digging ditches and stuff like that.
And then they found out that you did.
They found, yes.
And then they gave you this assignment to make this desk, mahogany desk.
Exactly, yes. I had
and
to.
You started making it.
I had to design
but
it.
You
and
never finished.
No, I never finished it.
Because it put you on a death march.
Yes, exactly. Yes, wow. On death march from Auschwitz, and then from Auschwitz.
What time of the year was that?
January of 1945.
So cold.
Very cold. Poland, snow, ice, and winter. We didn't have boots or shoes. We had wooden clogs with rags around our feet. And of course, it was a death march. After about 2.5 days, we arrived where we loaded up in trains. By that time, we were less than half of the people that had set out to march.
Oh, they were. Many people dropped out. When they dropped out?
Yeah, dropped out or killed, yeah, shot.
They shot.
Sir, just to go back a moment, so it was you and your brother. So were you still living near each other together, even though you had separate jobs? He was in the quarry and you were in the workshop?
Oh, we were still bunking in the same room. not necessarily side by side, that wasn't always possible, but in the same room. Yeah, we were sent off in different directions at work detail in the morning, yes. But we saw each other.
Talk about that relationship, because that must have been very important to you.
It was a very important. Again, it's also another one of my saving links, because sometimes you became disenchanted, to say it mildly, with the situation. But then, you know, either he or I, we each other would lift each other up and say, you know something, look, we are still managing, we are still working, and we hear some weird rumors that the Nazis are being defeated. Just hang in there yet, the Nazis will be defeated and we are going to make it yet. Another 2-3 weeks and that's all there is to it, we said to each other. And so this was important.
How long was that going on, where you were describing it as 2 or 3 weeks?
Probably a year, yeah.
And did you see the effects of hard labor on him?
Oh yeah, we all were very skinny, had lost weight, sure, of course, yeah. We could watch each other losing weight from day to day.
But his labor was harder, I
mean. Oh yes, his labor was harder.
Probably the food, probably not given much food either.
No,
to,
no, that's the point, yeah. Very, 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 water. Starving rations, yeah, starving
so
rations.
By January of 45, they were clearing Goldenstadt. What was the satellite camp that you were in? I'm sorry.
Goleschau.
They're clearing it out.
Yes. Yes, they're clearing out, and they cleared out Auschwitz altogether because the Russians came close and nobody was supposed to be liberated. So they eventually, after Dachau, but whoever was left, we were loaded up and we were sent to a camp at first by Berlin, a camp called Sachsenhausen, just for a short time, then another one for a few days. And then after we were loaded up again, and then we landed in a camp, Flossenbürg, down in southern Germany. Flossenbürg was a small camp. It's known to some people because one of the brave Lutheran ministers was executed there, Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Some people have heard about him. Yeah, he was executed there, which I didn't know at the time when I arrived. It was a camp that was built to hold about 1,600 people, and it was by now
the last camp you were in.
That was the last one, yeah. And so there was utter chaos. We arrived there in about February, beginning of February of 1945. And there was utter chaos.
Still cold.
Oh, yes. And nobody was sent to work anymore. By that time, that was also stone quarries around there. But the Allied bombardments had destroyed everything around there. So nobody was sent out to work. We were kept busy with the roll calls constantly, morning to evening, and just hanging around there, and that was all there is to it. And one food ration was missed because everything was out of control. And you could see people just collapsing left and right.
No protection from bombings?
No, of course not, no. Yeah. No, well, the bombers didn't come there then at that time, so when we were there.
Can we just go back to the march? So when you left Auschwitz and you were marched out of there, how long did that last?
Two and a half days, about.
And how many people were on the march?
I don't know the number.
But you said it was the conditions were so severe.
Yes, that less than half survived that march. Yes, and it's the same thing at the last march. From the last camp, I was on another death march. The same thing, Flossenbürg. There too, then eventually too, there was nothing going on, and eventually we heard that the that the Americans were nearby. Excuse me. We were heard that the Americans are coming close by. In fact, we heard from far away the noises of explosions and bombings and stuff. And we were waiting for them to come into the camp. Of course, it didn't happen. They weren't close by, but they moved by. Then we were again ordered out to build marching columns. And we were on another death march. And again, also for about 2.5 days. By that time, then also the same thing. And anybody that would fall behind or couldn't keep step with the Nazi guards on the side would fall behind or would stumble and fall because we were all weak, didn't get anything to eat. The Nazi guards were right there and shoot him in the head. And at the end of the column was a truck that loaded up the bodies. And when the truck was fully turned away, a new empty truck came, loaded up the bodies again. So we finally were marching, and I was keeping myself pretty much upright. I was aware of the fact that I wouldn't last much longer. And somebody hollers behind us, "Hey guys, look over there." And I looked over there and I saw what I still consider the most beautiful sight of my life, a contingent of armored American vehicles coming down the hillside. And our guards took off in all directions, and that's how we were freed. We were then taken to American Red Cross Station, and were then fed like little babies to begin with, and of course the American armored vehicles that came by, they were in fighting, it was a fighting column. They were shooting out of their turrets over our heads into German position. It was April 23rd, about 2 weeks before the end of the war. And they opened their hatches and threw out the ration boxes, which were some wonderful stuff. But regretfully, some of these guys didn't weigh more than 60, 65 pounds anymore. And they would eat everything in sight, and their bodies couldn't take that.
Oh my God, they couldn't take that.
Yeah, and they died because of that. But fortunately, the majority of us could control it.
We were warned about.
Well, you could figure out. Maybe you said to each other, you know, don't eat that fatty stuff. There was butter in there, sausages and heavy meat stuff, and so I just picked out something that looked benign to me, like some cookies, which I thought they tasted like the most wonderful thing I ever tasted. It turned out to be, I saw those cookies again when I came to America. I hadn't seen them since. It turned out nothing but it was saltine crackers at that time. So we were then taken care of.
What did this combat platoon or whatever they were, what did they say to you?
Nothing, they went by. The commander stopped. And it's a very interesting thing. If you will get a lot of stuff out of my book there yet that you can't go. In fact, this commander, and it's written in the book, I met by coincidence in St. Paul on a surprise. I didn't know who he was, where he was, but it turns out it was he, the conversation. So he directed us then to the Red Cross and said, the trucks will take us back there if we don't want to walk. It's about half a mile or so. And so, a buddy of mine and I, we walked. And it's an interesting story that you can read. It's too much to tell you all of it,
yeah.
You know. I'm lecturing at universities, sometimes 2-3 hours, and at high school it's 1.5 hours. So it's a lot. But I'm sure that you will get quite some additional information to what I touched on in the book.
Yeah.
Yes.
Let me just switch up.
The liberation moment.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, by the way, I mentioned a moment ago when I was liberated, it was April 23rd, about 2 weeks before the end of the war, actually. But it turns out to be also a very important day. So April 23rd is my mother's birthday. And I never saw her again, by the way. And out of my side of the family, my brother and I are the only survivors. So
what do you understand happened to her and Sonia?
Yes. Well, Sonia survived too, thank goodness. Mm-hmm. But she was in a different camp. My mother, it's actually a very tragic story. She was left behind in that other camp in Theresienstadt, the first one. And she was working there as a seamstress. And it was okay, and got along there, and there was no question about it. While she was a sickly person, she was also diabetic and needed her insulin, but she didn't get there, of course. But on the other hand, the food was so rare and little that actually wasn't that important, apparently. But she worked in a workshop. And when my brother and I were picked up, sent away, that was October of 44, about 7 months before the end of the war. When we were sent away, she, like a mother would do, went to the authorities, please send me to my sons. I want to be with my sons. Please send me to my sons. Now this camp, as I told you before, was a transition camp. And they constantly had transports going out of there constantly. And we were always looking for people to put transports together. And when they found some volunteers, they were very happy to do that. And so, of course, they took my mother and sent her also to Auschwitz, where she, we know from eyewitness, she was by that time a very sickly person. And as it turns out, she fell for this thing, come, we need you to work. If you're sick, if you need help, we will treat you first and then send you to work afterwards. She fell for that and went to the gas chambers. Yes.
Sonia traveled to Auschwitz with her?
Yes.
And
yes.
What happened to Sonia there? What was her experience there?
Sonia was separated from her then, of course. And she...
what was her experience there? So she and your mom went Auschwitz.
Yes, but so my mom was taken away from her, of course. And, and Sonja went to Auschwitz, and she soon was sent to another camp, too. She was liberated from a camp, I think, called Ravensburg, if I remember right. Yeah, yeah. Okay. So, yeah, well.
So what was the scene at the Red Cross?
The Red Cross was not a Red Cross with barracks or something. We were divided up among the population, the German population. I was put up, although we were first at something, we were first at some official place, you're right, though, there was something, where we carried that food ration box with me, you know. And there was one guy with all the goodies in there yet, which I hoped I could eat later, you know. And there was one guy that took the information from us, who we were and what so on and so forth, a Red Cross official. And he took that box away from us, which I was fighting not to give. And he was an American. I didn't speak English at those days. And he didn't speak German, and I didn't know what he wanted. I said, I didn't want to get rid of that box, no matter what. That was my prized possession. But anyway, somebody understood his English that you're going to get it back. This is the stuff you cannot have right now. Your name is being put on, and you're going to get back. And then I was put up at some farmer's house with some other people here, too. And so this farmer was ordered to take care of us. And it turned out to be he had to slaughter his last cow that he had for us to feed us eventually, which I didn't feel bad about.
Yeah.
You were with your brother at that.
Yes. No. Oh, no. Yeah, what I forgot to tell you, the last camp in Flossenbürg, 4 weeks before the death march, my brother and I were separated. They were looking for 1,000 men to be sent to another satellite camp that wasn't in existence, was to be created nearby. They wanted to build, that was towards the end of the war, and Germany had lost territory all over the places, fortunately. And they wanted to build an airfield. And so they needed 1,000 men. By that time, I was very, very sick. I had a swelling under my arm and could hardly keep myself up, and I was very sick. And my brother, and people were mustered out by Nazi doctors. And my brother said, well, we got to stay together. I needed his help. He was helping me by that time. And he says, you got to try to hide this. And I couldn't keep my arm even close to the body. There was a swelling like that on it. Yeah. And he says, keep your arm close together. You got to hide this so we can stay together. He knew that he would be chosen. He wasn't comparatively is the key word, good shape. So, of course, they detected me and we were separated. And the interesting thing is, as we talked about a moment ago, that our staying together was one of the blessings, one of the saving links. It turns out to be that we were separated as a saving link, because we would not have survived together as circumstances developed. In this camp that he was, I couldn't have worked there. They slept in the open fields outside. This was in March of 1945. They didn't have any barracks or nothing, and just worked on the field, digging, scraping, digging the ground and stuff like that. I couldn't have done that. I wouldn't have survived. Yeah, yeah, worked and slept. And so, then the end story is how I saved my life. I snuck out of the barracks, of my barracks, which I wasn't allowed to. I went to the sick barrack, to the barrack where sick people are handled. They had that for some more privileged prisoners, which I wasn't. But I knew I had to get there, and by coincidence, I make that too. And that's a whole story in itself, and you can see it in the book, a whole story in itself.
Yes. So what about reuniting with your brother and Sonja, how did that happen?
Well, that took a long time. I eventually went back to Berlin after the war was ended. As I said, April 23rd, the war wasn't over, and the American authorities, first of all, I had to get back on my feet anyways, which took a little bit. And then we were able to go anytime we wanted to, but the American authorities said, you better wait, because there are still pockets of Germans roaming around, and wisely they made the statement, you don't want to fall into their hands again. And so on, of course not. So we stayed. And I came back to my hometown, Berlin. I arrived there about a couple of months after the war ended. It was a long haul. It was probably a stretch of 700 miles. It took me nearly 4 or 5 weeks to get there. And my brother wasn't there, and I didn't know where he was. And it turns out to be that in my circumstances, the circumstances I was under, from his point of view at that time, and it would have been my own point of view, I had no way to survive. He didn't even look for me. This is not criticism. I wouldn't have done it either if I wouldn't do speech, because there was no way the next 4 or 5 weeks that was where I left that I could have survived. And so, but eventually then we found each other. He stayed in Munich. He didn't want to come back to Berlin. He figured nobody's there anymore. He was wise.
You went back to Berlin?
I went back to Berlin, yeah.
Did you go to your own home?
Yes.
Was someone else living there?
Oh, yes. The police came with me, and there were some Nazis living there which were thrown out, as we were thrown out. Yes.
And when you say police, you mean American MPs?
No, German police. It was Germany was defeated by that time, and the governments were gone. They had all newly established government positions, including the police. Yeah. And probably some of the old Nazis were in there too. But the guy that I met there was wonderful. Was wonderful.
And so who were these people in your apartment?
They were at the time. Germany was during the war bombed out. Badly all over the big cities, and all the living quarters were bombed out, and so the Nazis had first right to go into a Jewish home that was freed, or was opened up by transportation of Jews, and so these Nazis had the first choice, and these were some of these Nazis that were put into our house, into our home, with the furniture and all.
How did they react when you came, and how were they treated by the police?
Well, the police told him that I have the right to kick him out. And the police guy said, the policeman that was with me said, how long the time did they give you to clear your apartment? I said, 15 minutes. He said, you give him 15 minutes and I'll be with you. And they throw things together and out they go. And as I came to the house, there was some old couple living there, old Nazis as it turns out, as it was turned out. And she cried, and she said, oh gosh, I got to get to my daughter, I got to get in touch with my daughter. Can't I stay till tomorrow morning at least? It was late in the afternoon, almost evening. And like an idiot, I said, yes, go.
You're a good guy.
Yeah, I was stupid too. Because when I came over the next morning, and the policeman said to me, Henry, don't be an idiot, he said, don't do that. And I thought I was pretty mean when I said, but by 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, you're out of here. I thought I was pretty mean at that, and I came at 8 o'clock, the door was wide open, and whatever was to be carried out, except the furniture, all other stuff that was our stuff, linens and stuff like that from before, was carried out. There was nothing left in there. I didn't worry about it. Nothing mattered at those days. I wanted to find out about my family and my friends, which I didn't know yet what happened.
And what about, when did you find out that your brother was not in Berlin, but Munich and Sonia?
Well, by coincidence, somehow. There were slips put on businesses and offices all over. I'm looking for so and so, an idea, and so. I come to think of right now, I'm not even sure anymore how I found out. My brother was in Munich, and he was functioning as a cantor, and he would even have services, Friday night services, over the radio. And I picked it up in Berlin. Yeah, and so. And I did the same thing. I was not a cantor, but I was cantorially active.
So you heard him identified as Kurt Messerschmitt on the radio?
Yes, yes.
Or you recognized his voice?
No, the radio, yeah. On the radio. Yeah.
And
well,
had he gotten back in touch with Sonia by then? Or?
Yeah, that was also a longer story. They didn't find each other right away either. Sonia and I got in touch with each other first before we knew about Kurt. Yeah, and she said, and then suddenly, somehow, I don't know how she heard of him in Munich. She heard of him in Munich then too. And then she went to Munich. She was in a different town, and she went to Munich then to stay with him there.
If we can bring it up to date, because we're running tight on time.
So, yeah.
You were liberated by the Americans.
Mm-hmm.
And,
the General Patton's army.
General Patton.
Yeah.
So how did you come to, where did you, when you left Germany, where did you leave from?
From Berlin.
Coming to the States.
To the States, well, from Berlin to the town of Bremerhaven, where the ships are leaving from, Bremerhaven. And then from there, we came to New York.
Did you have family?
Did I? Yeah. Steffi was 13 months old.
Oh.
Yes, she was 13 months old. And of course, Inge, my wife, yeah.
Yeah. So you arrived in New York.
Statue of Liberty. Yeah, oh yes, this was so important that I wrote about it in my book too. It was quite.
Must have been the statue. Emotional.
It wasn't a very emotional moment. We were the ship was anchored overnight in front of the social, of the Statue of Liberty, right in front of it all night long, and people were crying. Yeah.
No surprise.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
They were all tears of survivors.
Or? All of them.
Yeah, tears of.
That was it. Was a troop transport ship that we came in. I got a picture of it in my room of that ship. Yeah.
Tears of joy.
Oh yes, yeah. Yes. Wow.
So from New York, you went to where?
Went to St. Paul.
St. Paul.
Yes. Lived in St. Paul for a while, for a while all along. This year is Little Canada. It's part of St. Paul, the outskirts of St. Paul. But first we lived in the city.
When were you married?
We were married in 1946, 1 year after the war.
Where?
In Berlin.
In Berlin.
In Berlin still, yes. Yeah. And Steffi was born in 1948, and we came to the States in 1949. Yeah.
Why didn't you go to Munich to be with your brother?
Why what?
Why didn't you go to Munich to be with your brother?
We did visit him, okay. But we didn't want to live him. My wife and I, we went to visit them there, yes.
And so did you, before you left Berlin, did you and Inga live in the apartment, that same apartment?
Yes, the same apartment that I was picked up from, yes.
And you found out about your mother from Sonia, basically. Is
yes, that, yes, know? She told us the situation, yeah.
And why St. Paul?
We had no choice. We were sponsored by an organization. I didn't have enough money myself to come over here after all. We had lost everything, and we didn't get anything back yet, you know. And the job that I had after the war was not paying that much. I was professionally singing in the choir and soloists and so on and so forth. But we didn't have any money. So at this time, there was the refugee organization, not the highest, the other one. I forget right now what it was. Oh, my gosh. I'll come back to it. Senior moment here. I should know that organization. And so they sponsored the survivors and to come to America. They paid for everything. They even tried to find jobs right away. And so and they also, by doing so, they reserved the right to send you where they decide to send you to. Because if you would ask any European, they all want to go to New York or Los Angeles or Chicago. And so you would have whole millions or thousands and thousands of people that bunched up there. So they, in their wisdom, and it was a good idea, they said, you go there and you go. And when I sort of protested, I wanted to stay in New York. They said, you know something, you go to St. Paul, you can stay in New York, yes. But if you have no way to live and you can't find a job, we are not supporting you because your budget is in St. Paul and you can't get it here. And then if so, you got to go to your friends for help if need be. Yeah. But they said too, you know, go to St. Paul. And once you're on your own feet, we don't care where you go. Once you're on your feet, you can go any place you want to. But we are not supporting you any place else for the first 5 years. And so that made sense. And of course, we were unhappy to go to St. Paul because we were big city slickers from Berlin. St. Paul was, of course, then much smaller than it is now. And we were not happy to begin with. But we are still here and we are happy. So we don't want to go up to New York. We don't want to go and live in New York.
What about your medical training and your new profession, right? I mean, how did that all come about?
My what training?
Medical training? Are you, did
no.
you have medical training?
No.
What did you wind up? What
we were in a choir.
I was singing. Yeah.
Right, but when you came
music,
here?
When I worked, I used my woodwork skills in the beginning, yes. And about 5 years afterwards, I started to get a job at, first of all, 2 years afterwards, I started a job to get at a furniture store, one of the huge furniture stores here that was here, Cardozo's, you wouldn't know that. There was the largest furniture, Cardozo's.
Cardozo's?
Cardozo's, yeah, it was a huge 10-story furniture store.
How do you
C-A, like the Cardozo's family, C-A-R-D-O-Z-O, Cardozo.
They still exist?
No, not anymore, no.
And you were making furniture for them?
No, I was selling furniture for them, yeah.
Oh,
but they hired me because I have the knowledge of it. It was a real, very, very good store, very, very honest store. And they hired me because I would know how to talk about furniture was their reasoning. And I worked for them for 5 years until I sold furniture to an officer of the Prudential Insurance Company. And he approached me and wanted me to get into the insurance business, which I did. I was with about 30 years, worked for Prudential for nearly 30 years.
Wow. And so where was Prudential here? I don't don't know where that.
Well, they have offices. It's the largest insurance company.
Yeah,
they have offices all over the places.
Right.
They had here in St. Paul downtown an office at that time. In fact, two offices. There were district offices and regular offices.
And that's
where I worked downtown St. Paul in the beginning. Yes. Yes.
Excellent.
Good.
Yeah, I did. I'm sorry. Did you have anything else?
What?
Did you have anything else?
I don't think so. I think you have two children.
Yes, two children, Steffi and her brother, David.
Okay, where is he?
He's living in Bloomington here, in the neighborhood, in South Minneapolis, Bloomington.
There's a Bloomington, Illinois. And
there's
Bloomington
two, yeah, Bloomington, yeah, there's a Bloomington here, yes.
And there's a Highland Park here. And
Highland Park in
Chicago,
yes. Yes.
Henry, it's interesting, we interviewed a man named Mike Silver in outside of Chicago. He happens to be Wolf Blitzer's uncle.
Oh.
Even as being kind of having such a high-profile nephew, he really never told anybody his story.
Mm-hmm.
When we interviewed him, he was anxious about it for about a month before we even came.
Yeah, many people don't talk about it yet, yeah. Didn't.
But you've lived a very different life in terms
mm-hmm.
of being public with it. And can you just talk about that and what that's meant?
Well, it probably for the first 20 years, sort of like almost, you couldn't get me to talk about it. Like most any survivor didn't want to talk about it, not even to the families. And then suddenly a teacher approached me and said there was an exhibition here and I was hosting it reluctantly. I was one of the hosts. Schools came around and I was supposed to explain. And one of the teachers practically forced me to come to her school. She said she has no respect if I don't, because if nobody talks about it to the kids will never learn. And so reluctantly I said I'm going to give her 20 minutes and I'm going to come to her school. And from then on it mushroomed, of course. And the local JCRC, the Jewish Community Relations Council at that time, was active in looking for speakers and providing speakers. And then I came to the conclusion that it is very important. And I became very, very active.
Okay. What happened at that? So that must have been in the 60s.
Yeah,
you were giving
in the 60s,
talk
yeah.
What was the response from the students and what happened?
Tremendous response from the students and the teachers. I got stacks of letters and over the years and universities. I spoke literally in dozens of universities and the high schools here, dozens over the years, over 40 years.
That first experience, it kind of made you think, wow, this is, first of all, these people didn't know about this history.
Yeah, they didn't know. And so, it started to mushroom. And there are some very dedicated teachers, Christian teachers, not Jewish teachers, that are constantly pushing it that the people hear
Thank
about
goodness.
It, and not just necessarily for the reason of what happened to the Jews, for the reason what can happen when hatred goes wild and uncontrolled. That's the main reason. That's my main reason for speaking too.
Do you tend to tie when you talk? Do you tend to tie it in with stuff that's happening in the present, or even if you talk about Rwanda or stuff?
Nowadays, I mention it, yes, of course. But when I'm talking, although lately I don't talk any. I haven't done anything like that for a while. Yeah, because I'm getting tired of it now.
Is there a Holocaust association here?
The university has the Holocaust and Genocide Department, university here. Very active, very wonderful.
In Phoenix, we have a group called the Phoenix Holocaust Survivors Association, and they have 200 members.
Yeah, there's the.
And I wonder if they have anything like that.
Not like this here, no. Not like this here. And frankly, I tell you what, I wouldn't be interested in it.
Oh.
Why should I go and wallow about these things all the time with other people? I'm glad they survived. And if they want to do it, but I wouldn't go to meetings just to talk about it because I'm talking too much about it. Talked about it too much as it was.
Does it ever trouble you that the more you give talks, I mean, you must see that kids just still don't know about this. I mean, their context,
well,
their understanding of history is still
yeah.
pretty bad.
Well, you know something, I'm under the adage like, if I reach out of 100 kids, if I reach a couple or three of them that really know what I've done, I've done my job. You cannot reach everybody. You cannot. And I got letters from kids, as well as some adults. They said that they had no idea and that I changed their lives. Many of them write that to me and got letters from them. It's
wow.
a wonderful thing. Yeah,
so important.
Yeah. That from now on they are thinking about. They never thought about those things. Some kids write me that they understand now what hate means and they will never hate again and stuff like that. This is good.
There's still deniers out there.
Well, there are sure.
Yeah.
This gentleman at the University of Minnesota, somebody had told me, but he passed away not too long ago,
yes.
Right, the head of that department.
Yes, Steve Feinstein,
Steve
yes.
Feinstein.
What a wonderful man he was. Oh, I worked with him very closely.
Okay.
And his successor is Ellen Kennedy, and she's very, very good too. And they're looking for a replacement. Ellen Kennedy is the interim director.
Did she come from within that department? Or
yes,
okay.
Yes.
But are they doing like a nationwide search?
Yes, yes.
Okay. When do they hope to find you?
I have no idea.
Okay.
No idea.